And finally, we'll end with Bitcoin obituaries. How many times has Bitcoin died? January 3rd, 2009 was the Genesis block. This was in the headlines of that day on the London Times, Chancellor on the brink of the second bailout for banks. The Bitcoin network was quietly activated with no fanfare. Nobody noticed. Code was supposedly, he told people later, in development since 2007. He embedded a hash into the Genesis block in hexadecimal format that I don't think was discovered for a while that had that headline in it. And he did that so people would know that the Genesis block could not have started before that day. It's like taking a kidnapper and putting them with your kidnappy with a headline so they know it's today. This is the hash that actually created the information. And this was coded right inside the first transaction, and I highlighted it in yellow. That's where he actually put the headline in there that people discovered later. And there's the actual picture of the newspaper. And as a fun fact, that issue, if you can find it, is now a collector's item. Very hard to find, very expensive because of the historical nature of it. This is Hal Finney. He was the first person that was actually transferred Bitcoin from Satoshi himself. This was, I think, 10 days after the Bitcoin network went live. He helped with a bit of the coding on it. He came from PGP. He was one of the founders of the PGP encryption set. Very intelligent guy. He ran Bitcoin on his own computers, on his laptop at his home. We'll go on. And he gave up when it became too hot. He mined for a couple of months, and it got harder and harder and harder as other people climbed on board, and his wife started to complain about it, so he unplugged it. But by then, he had tens of thousands of Bitcoin. He died in 2014 from Lou Gehrig's disease, and people always asked him, "Are you the real Satoshi?" And he always denied it, but there's still some suspicion that if he wasn't Satoshi, he was helpful to Satoshi, or if Satoshi was more than one person, he might have been involved. He would find himself at the later part of another wild goose chase, in a strange coincidence we'll talk about later. Papa John Pizza. Does anybody know here the connection to Bitcoin and Papa John Pizza? This happened to be the first item, real world item, that was purchased with Bitcoin. This was a kind of a bet between people, two people have been going for 18 months by now. Just computer geeks, programmers run it as hobby things. And they were all wondering, how much is a Bitcoin worth? And one guy made a projection that if you calculated the electricity that it costs for your computer to actually mine a Bitcoin, it gave it a real world value of about a tenth of a penny. And so after 18 months, they thought, well, somebody needs to buy something to set the price. So we have a floor on this. And so two Papa John Murphys was the actual price. A guy in Florida talked into a guy in England to be able to call up this delivery guy in Florida, send him two Papa John pizzas, and then he would transfer 10,000 bitcoins to the guy in England for it. So these pizzas cost $10,000, around $8 million today. Most expensive pizza you'll find, I'll bet you. Being a little bit slow. In March 2011, the biggest Bitcoin exchange for quote-unquote real money was Mt. Gox. It was designed to trade magic cards, Magic the Gathering online exchange. So it wasn't built with a lot of security in mind. These cards were, you know, a dollar or two, very light traffic. The guy who ran it was a project manager. He wasn't even a CEO. He didn't have any business experience. So his security wasn't very good. He wrote in PGP web, language, without any security backend. In April 2011, the first mainstream news article was written about it from Time magazine. And as a coincidence, two years later, Time magazine named Satoshi Nakamoto the man of the year. December 2011, Satoshi made his final post. He indicates that he's done with the project and he's moved on to other projects. There's the Time magazine of the year. Some Bitcoin first. Grass Hill Alpacas. They sold alpaca socks. And they were the first merchant to actually accept Bitcoin. And I think the network had been turned over to Gavin Anderson at that point. He was out there soliciting people that, hey, try this Bitcoin thing, trying to build a market, get some place to try it. And these people said, well, they're on a farm and they, you know, didn't have anything to lose. They said, okay, sure, we'll try it. Mike Caldwell of Salt Lake City is the first person to actually make little Bitcoin tokens. He did it out of the Salt Lake City garage. And the picture you see on the right is now used in newscasts everywhere. If they need to picture, you know, give somebody the idea of what Bitcoin looks like, that's what they give them. So there's some visual, it's not just gas and smoke. And now if you happen to own one of these Bitcoins, I pulled this up at eBay yesterday, they're going for $3,200 if they're still loaded with a Bitcoin on them. So they're historical collector items now. So I was pretty happy. I bought one a few years ago. I thought this was going to be historical. And so I bought one on eBay while they were fairly cheap. Mike Caldwell was shut down by the government for quote unquote minting coins. And he wasn't getting identification from people as he was selling his coins. So they said, no, you can't do that. That's money. That could be money laundering. You don't know who's getting your coins. So they actually shut him down. But he became a multimillionaire. Just having these coins that these little addresses, he put on a token, a hologram on the token itself, so he'd hide the private key underneath the token that he had to peel off, and it was tamper resistant, so you couldn't peel off and then put it back on. And so, yeah, he became an instant millionaire just as these things caught on. To get all kinds of security for his house, as he just did it in his house. He lived in Sandy. So here's a list of hacks, scams, accidents, the top 10 sad stories of lost Bitcoin. Remember, this wasn't expected to be a great big thing in the early days. And so it was not impossible to just transfer money into nothing, a bad address, or accidentally delete your drive. But see, here's some of the biggest ones. This guy lost, the guy on top, 9,000 Bitcoins, now worth 8 million. They were zero when he destroyed them. They had no cost. You see, as you go down, you know, some of these. Bitfloor hacked, there's a lot of exchanges that was hacked. And really, the big exchanges that we know today, the multi-million dollar Wall Street-backed firms, they didn't exist, and no one was giving it a shot. So these guys were project managers or hobbyists. They're geeks that started a server in their basement and didn't have a lot of experience in security, and things went happen. These, you know, as the maturity of Bitcoin expanded, these guys got knocked out. A lot of them had, you see. Mt. Gox was the biggest. 450,000 were stolen at a cost of around $405 million now. That set a long-term trend for Bitcoin throughout 2014 of people that were just, they can read the headlines and they're nervous. And you see, the latest is just recently. FitNex exchange in China, they went down just in the summertime. They lost 120,000 for now 108 million. So at the bottom, we see $966 million of hacks, scams, and fun stories to tell your grandkids if you're one of those people that lost millions of dollars in their inheritance.
So Mark,
yes?
I see on the slide here, there's the majority of these are in the U.S. What are the tax ramifications?
So he's asking about the tax ramifications of people that lost Bitcoin.
No, just in general, in terms of using Bitcoin, most of these are out of the U.S.
Right. So how does the IRS consider Bitcoin for tax purposes? It's considered an asset like gold, so you have capital gains tax that you have to recognize on that. So, yeah, it would be the same as if you were buying a house or land or real estate. They consider it property. So long-term and short-term capital gains, I think 30% if you sell it in the first year, and I think it drops to 20% or 15%. I'm not sure. They adjusted the tax laws recently. So but you do have to record it. And if you have an account with like Coinbase, the market exchanges, they'll send you a 1099 or the equivalent at the end of the year with your net gains and losses. And so there's a lot of people that took losses, and I think they limit, what's unfair, they limit the losses. They'll count all your gains. But $3,000, I think, was the cap when I was counting losses when I was selling some in 2014. So I have a funny video I found about the press reactions on this that I want to play.
Let's move on to Bitcoin, shall we? That's a virtual currency. We're going to talk about the cyber threat now. Who's ever heard of the Bitcoin? It's even been called the future of money, the Bitcoin.
More on this cryptic and still somewhat confusing currency that is Bitcoin.
People are fascinated by anything that makes new highs every day for weeks on end, which Bitcoin has done.
Is it a market? Is it a bank? Is it an exchange?
We're asking whether or not this currency really has any longevity, let alone legitimacy.
You'd have to be an idiot not to know how much risk you're bearing if you purchase Bitcoin.
The value of it, I mean, look at the chart, is sinking and skyrocketing.
If this is a commodity, it's no different than the tulip mania of the 1600s.
Feds are starting to crack down on so-called virtual currencies.
Wild West currency had a bad stigma. People said that it was being used for narco trafficking, potentially to back terrorism efforts.
Some rumors that it's this Japanese guy, but they know that he's a fake name, it's a pseudonym.
I mean, they're literally putting real money on a system that we don't even know who created it.
Is this legitimate in your view?
It is legitimate and it is a fascinating experiment.
It's an interesting brain tell, though. It really is for people who around the world who are obsessed with fiat currency.
Not silver,
and
the Trump Association. What about the increasing billions of dollars of money laundering right there? Look, the current scandal is another problem.
People are
scared by the banking in this country and around the world.
But the banking crisis there does raise the intriguing question of what is money?
What exactly is Bitcoin and how does it work?
There is no central bank, no central authority. No corporation behind it.
Knows no borders, knows no boundaries, and in many cases knows no rules.
It's a new internet protocol like email or the web.
Yeah. All this is done on peer-to-peer networks. Nobody really even knows who created the Bitcoin.
Developed entirely on an open platform.
No one's in charge.
Free
totally
market.
Decentralized.
Okay, so
the value of each Bitcoin hit a new high. It has, as this chart shows, been skyrocketing in value over the past 3 years. I know some people are obsessed with this and have been all over this quote unquote phenomenon.
So many people are jumping into this virtual currency. It's created so much attention. One of the biggest Bitcoin exchanges actually reported that it was having trouble technologically keeping up with all the order flow.
Its unknown creator sending a finite number of the digital currency, 21 million, with only 11 million in circulation.
The maximum amount of Bitcoins that could ever exist on the planet is 21 million Bitcoins.
Some would argue that it is more useful as a form of money because it cannot be debased by people like Ben Bernanke or Mr. Trudeau.
Is no inflation because you don't run the risk of anyone printing the currency.
Geek currency, Bitcoin, has been under fire recently for its dramatic price swing. Is it just going to keep on going up?
Now, you didn't bite at the Bitcoin craze. You may have saved yourself some money. Mary Thompson is here. What was that with the flash crash?
Everybody's been talking about it, and hackers are actually to blame for this most recent sell-off. Last night, the digital currency's major exchange, Mt. Gox, as it's called, was hit with a denial-of-service attack.
What do you make of this madness?
Well, I think Bitcoin has turned into a massive multiplayer online game where speculators are trying to out-speculate each other.
Despite the extreme volatility, this is...
Well, it looks like the end of the workable video on this, but you get the idea that they're confused and going crazy, and they don't know what to make of it, and the price really caught everybody off guard. Price, to me, is about the least interesting thing about Bitcoin, but it's the thing that catches people's attention the first, and they want to concentrate, and they don't know about the technology, they don't know it's a protocol. They see, you know, another, just a currency, and a freaks them out that they don't understand the nature of money like you guys do. So let's talk about some of the misinformation. Some of these so-called quote-unquote experts on there trying to advise people about this and are completely wrong.
But they're trying to reinvent the wheel, and they've come up with a flat tire. We already have a perfect real form of money, and it's called gold. Money has to have four elements. It has to be very rare, indestructible, divisible without losing its purchasing power, and cannot be increased by fiat.
So, how many lies did he tell there?
And Bitcoins fail on the first two. They are not rare, and they are very much destructible. So hacking Bitcoin could be a problem, but what about someone coming up with a counterfeit that end users don't recognize as being counterfeit? And then loading the purchasing power of all existing
$1 billion.
It's a novelty for the Geek Squad. I can assure you, if these became well promulgated, then the U.S. government would shut it down.
It's just...
Okay, so let's call those out a little bit. Not rare. At current count, there are 17 million that have been released. There will be a total of 21 million released by the year 2140. So we still have 120 years before the last Bitcoin is released. Now, in about 2045, it's going to get very flat very quick. So they're going to get portions of the Bitcoin for 100 years. But the last one, as it goes down, will not quite reach 21 million. Is it destructible? Well, no, you can't destroy math. It's all a protocol done by math. But you can send it to an unspendable address. So technically, you can kind of destroy it. But you're not really destroying the Bitcoin. You're destroying your key to the Bitcoin. That's the key. The coin still sits there. You can wash it forever. The guy with the landfill, they buried his hard drive in the landfill. It's still there. You can go see his Bitcoin right there. He just lost his keys to it. So that's the difference. It's widely considered unhackable. I read this article in Business Insider. I tried to hack Bitcoin and failed. This guy, Dan Kleminski, he's probably the world's premier security researcher. When you hear about the hacks from Russia, you hear about them all over the world. And you see the virus reports, the guy who found Susnex and whatnot, it's this guy. And this was when, back in 2012, 13, and the network was 100 what it is now. And he said, as it gets bigger and stronger, it becomes more impossible to hack. Are you able to counterfeit it? No, we haven't talked about that too much yet, but it's created through the world's most powerful network in the world, getting astronomical numbers. They're doing in the quintillions calculations per second to be able to get the randomized number that creates the seed that creates a Bitcoin. You can't substitute that. You can't infuse, and you can't, they call it planting cut daisies. You can't pretend there's a coin in the middle, because it all comes from a seed through a tree, and everything is tracked, chained together. So you can't just insert something into the chain. And will the U.S. government shut it down? Heavens no. The U.S. government is promoting it. They look at futures for crime, because you cannot ever cover your tracks through the blockchain. There is always some record. And they look at just paper cash, which they cannot track very well, and they say, well, we'll take the Bitcoin over paper cash. Thank you very much. So let's talk about some cast of characters, the good, the bad, and the bizarre. And I think I have slides talking about all of these, but I'll give you a quick introduction. The guy on the very far left, top left, is Gavin Anderson. He's the guy who took over from Satoshi, the head of the Bitcoin code. Next guy is Eric Voorhees. He operated the first big, large Bitcoin company that handled more than half of all Bitcoin traffic at one point. The next guy, second to the right, is Roger Ver. They also call him Bitcoin Jesus, because he gave away and promoted Bitcoin in his first year like crazy. He gave away probably hundreds of millions of dollars worth in today's money, but he was giving away tens of thousands. He advertised on the radio, over 100 radio stations, and he took out billboards in San Francisco and the Silicon Valley telling people about Bitcoin and his web. He went to some websites that went crazy when he started putting those billboards up. The guy on the far right is Vitalik Buterin. And at this point, he was 18 years old. He's the one who co-founded Bitcoin Magazine and Ethereum, which we have a whole section on in a few weeks. The guy on the bottom left is Charlie Shrim. He was just out of high school in his early 20s. He built up the first exchange in the United States and was arrested, spent years in prison because he wasn't licensed for it. The next guy in the bottom middle is Ross Ulbricht, also known as Dread Pirate Roberts. He's the guy they caught and convicted for running the Silk Road. The guy second to the right is Mark Knopples, I believe his last name is. He's the guy, he's the bozo that ran Mt. Gox, the project manager, and we'll talk about him a little bit more. The guy in the very right, could it be Satoshi Nakamoto? That's Craig Wright, who claims he's Satoshi Nakamoto. Early Bitcoin millionaires, where are they now? Well, Charlie Sheeran, we talked about him. He just got out of jail after 2 years. He says while he was in prison, he taught the inmates all about Bitcoin, how to use it, how to spend it. So we have all new kinds of felons knowing how to run Bitcoin. That's not a bad thing. But he's an entrepreneur, so you gotta do what entrepreneurs gotta do, right? Roger Ver, the AKA Bitcoin Jesus. We talked about him a little bit. Now he would be worth millions. One interesting story about him is someone hacked his email account and it threatened to expose all his personal detail information. What did he do? He fought back. He said, all right, I will give $20,000 in Bitcoin to the first guy who tells me who this is. Because you guys know, you hackers, there's no honor among hackers. You find me, give me his name, and I'll give you $20,000. The guy gave up that day. He said, I'm sorry, here's your information back. I will never touch you again. And that was the end of it. So Bitcoin Jesus rocked it solid when he had to. Eric Voorhees, we talked about, he ran the website, it's a gambling website called Satoshi Dice. Very simple game, if you want to call it that, where you bet basically up or down. You bet a certain amount of coin that's going to be the next random number is going to be positive or negative. And if it was, depending on how much coin you get a percentage of that. And that accounted for over 50% of all Bitcoin traffic for the first couple of years of people when they started discovering it. Simple idea, and he made it work. He sold the company in 2013, I think, for the dollar amount was $11.5 million, but he sold it all in Bitcoin. At that point, he had amassed on the website 126,000 Bitcoin. So you think, wow, that's a nice deal, right? $11.5 million? Well, that's $114 million today if he would have held out a couple more years. And he's now the operator. He's very influential in Bitcoin. He runs a company called Shapeshift, which is very interesting because there are many dozens of big cryptocurrencies now that go along with Bitcoin, Ethereum being one. We'll talk about it in a few weeks, some others. But here you can, without an account, without signing up, transfer one to the other. You just need to have a Bitcoin address. So if you have a full Bitcoin that you want to change to Ethereum, you can put your address in Ethereum and it'll give you a QR code to send to the one, and within a couple of minutes it goes to the exchanges and then deposits you in the currency that you would like to see. And this is interesting because you can do this without signing up any forms and putting your name down. And so some people wonder, well, you know, could this be bad? I'm sure it probably can be. But he's within the limits. He runs it, I think, out of Panama, and there are certain limits on the dollar amounts that he can get away with without getting into trouble. So he's within the law, and this is a lot of people love Shapeshift because of this. They can maintain some privacy and be exchanging in and out of different blockchains, different currencies at the same time, and remain somewhat anonymous, being able to, if people are tracking you on one blockchain, it's going to be a lot tougher to track you through several blockchains. And some of them are very anonymous, like if you want to call it Dash, that runs onion ring routing between coins and makes it very difficult to find. So Shapeshift's important. Yeah, he says it could be a money laundering thing. It could be. But I would imagine every federal detective agency of every country has a feed right into that, and he gives API feeds for anybody who wants to use that as an automated fashion. If you open an Ethereum wallet right now, if you download the program for Ethereum, it has built-in Shapeshift. So if you have Bitcoin and you want to fund your Ethereum account, it's built right into their wallet. So it's pretty important. Gavin Anderson, we talked about him. He's the one who got Satoshi Nakamoto's the keys to run the Bitcoin network. They have a GitHub repository. It's all open source, so anybody can make submissions to it, but he had the key to write that to the final code, and he shared that with a couple of other people too. He wasn't the only one with that access. He told Satoshi in his last conversation through email. No one ever talked to Satoshi on a phone or in person. It was all through an anonymous account, that he was asked by the CIA to go speak with them, to give a talk or to give them some information about Bitcoin. And he said he agreed to do that. And Satoshi had no other communication after that. No goodbyes. No, I don't think that's a good idea. That was just it. He had already mentioned that he was getting out of it. He's moving on to other things. And sort of protected the network up until then. But that was the last we heard of that. Now, Gavin came into the news again recently. He hasn't been really involved with Bitcoin much the last year or two. He's kind of went on to other things as well, Gavin has. But he came to light when Craig Wright here on the very bottom right mentioned, I am Satoshi Nakamoto, and I can prove it. And Gavin said, well, if you can prove it, the only way you can do that, as far as I'm concerned, is you can sign from his address, from his original Bitcoin wallet that we know was him when he mined it. If you can send a signature that shows you have the key to that, we'll believe you. And so Craig did some things on TV, and we'll talk about in the next section, that convinced Gavin that he is the real Satoshi Nakamoto. And he pulled a lot of grief for that, and you see here on the bottom left, I was wrong to make the mistake of claiming that he was Satoshi Nakamoto. So he's doubting himself, but we'll talk about that later. That Vitalik, we talked about him a little bit. He started Bitcoinizing. He's a college dropout. Got into Bitcoin. He's a super genius, though. In another couple of weeks, we'll talk about how smart he is and the things he's done. This is the very first issue of Bitcoin Magazine. That was the initial, you know, if you think of Wired Magazine and Byte Magazine, they all had their first edition on these paradigm changes. So that was the first, and this is now a collector items that you pay big money to be able to collect now. And at 20 years, he started the Ethereum blockchain. He's 22 years old now, so that's been going. The program from its conception is about 2 years old now. So the guy who's ran now, Mark Karpeles, and we see not very flattering pictures of him here, but that kind of captures his personality. He's a French guy, lived in Japan. Mt. Gox was in Japan. Actually, people call it Mt. Gox, but if people... somewhat facetious, they call it MT Gox because it was emptied. It has no Bitcoin in it, it's MT Gox. Stood for Magic the Gathering Online Exchange. The Mt. Gox was terrible because they were responsible for all the huge Bitcoin crashes. They were hacked 3 different times, and the price reflected the hack. People think the hack where they went bankrupt was the worst, but no, in 2011, it dropped 90%. It went from a high of about $30 down to $2 after it was hacked. And people speculate that he never really recovered from that. It became a Ponzi scheme as new people were coming in and it went great while the price went up. But he didn't have the Bitcoin to pay people if they were going to withdraw it. And so it eventually collapsed on him. So they suspect it could be an inside job too, but they haven't been able to prove it. They've actually indicted him and arrested him, and I think he got off. So, one of the things you make you wonder is that they originally said he lost $650,000. Magically, after a couple of days, he found a cold wallet storage that held 200,000 coins. Oh, oops. Yeah, there's some. Headlines that might have sank Bitcoin price, but actually fueled its growth. Anybody know who Chuck Schumer is? Senator Chuck Schumer? Chuck, great guy. Yeah, he wanted to make headlines, so he called the reporters over to his office and said, we've just discovered this online place called Silk Road, and it's on the dark web, and people pay using this thing called Bitcoin. And all these drug addicts around the world says, huh, Bitcoin? What's Bitcoin? And so the price went up 1,000%, thanks to Chuck. Bitcoin's best friend. Bitcoin bonanza, Cyprus crisis, boost the digital dollars. People started doing the bank bail-ins when crisis started going under, and they were taking people's funds. They were taking what they call the haircut. Well, now 3% of what you have in your bank is now mine. Thank you very much. People rushed to whatever they could find for ATMs, and they say that was the reason Bitcoin went up 400%. The FBI eventually shuts down the Silk Road that fall. In about November, they find Ross Ulbricht, and they seize the domains, and they put up the big FBI warnings, and people said, well, that's the end of Bitcoin, because that's the only reason people use Bitcoin, is to buy illegal drugs, right? So how could Bitcoin retain its value if it doubled the price? Within a week, it had dipped just a tiny little bit, and people said, what? People still are using Bitcoin. It must not be all drug-related. So the price shot up. Then there were Senate hearings in November, just a month following the shutdown of the Silk Road, and people said, this is it. They called in all the big Bitcoin people, evangelists of the starting the companies and the Wall Street firms that were just starting to dip their toes into it, and the people that could represent it well, the Bitcoin Foundation. And they held 2 days of hearings. I provided links in this PowerPoint, so you'll have you'll be able to access those right on YouTube. They were recorded. They happened to mention the Senate that they broadcast each of these Senate hearings for everything they do. They broadcast live, and they happened to mention this one was the most watched that they had ever seen for any case for any time. This broke their records by 10 times, watching, having the world find out what they were going to say about this new currency thing. And Bitcoin went up 200%. As the people said, oh, this was a love fest. And they said, not only are they dogging this thing, they had the people that broke the Silk Road case, the FBI agents coming in there, the Homeland Security, and they had the lady in charge of the financial tech, the fintech lady, and the IRS, the people from the IRS, and they all said, well, we don't have a problem with this. This looks like a good, legitimate currency. And we can see a lot of positive things from this, and helping people that are unbanked in the third world have access to their phones. And, well, yeah, there's some negativity here, but really, in the big scheme of all the corruption and fraud we see, this is nothing. This wouldn't even cost somebody to clock in. Bitcoin went up another 200%. China got involved and says, you know what? People kind of want to trade this thing. We're kind of looking at it. I think we're okay. I think, you know, this Bitcoin thing, you know, from what we hear, watch that Senate thing, I think we can deal with that. Bitcoin went up another 200%. Now you add these things together, and the process of about a month, and that was over 1,000%, 10 times price increase in about a month's time. So around $100 to over $1,000 in about a month. All on quote-unquote bad news. The Silk Road, the interesting twists and tales. So it starts with Chuck Schumer. He's going to shut down that big drug market. Here is the webpage for the Silk Road. You can buy all kinds of drugs and passports and fake identities. I don't think they sold guns or anything like that. They outlawed child pornography that just no one would put up with. But prescription drugs, and there was occasionally, from what I understand, I never visited the site, but there was legitimate things people could put on there too, maybe alpaca socks or whatever. But this became the hot item for a few months. So some of the headlines caught the irony with the enemies like Schumer, who needs friends? Bitcoin's best friend. This is the guy who ran it that they found in San Francisco, young kid, a big libertarian type. Was actually an amazingly smart kid, got a nice education, very tops in his class, Eagle Scout, community standard, loved his brothers and sisters, family, he was a great family, whatever, girlfriends. Bright young kid, just kind of got involved with this thing that took him away. He was at a library when they finally caught him with his laptop open, still managing Silk Road stuff. So they had him dead to rights. FBI found on the Silk Road, on his websites, 170,000 Bitcoin. So what do you do if you're the FBI and you just seized 170,000 Bitcoin and it just, you know, went up 10 times in price? So it was, might have been over, you know, 170 million when they first got their hands on it, and it shot up in price. So if the government hates Bitcoin, like the guy on the TV suggests, of course the government's going to burn that thing. It's not going to let that back out. What did they do with it? They sold it. They auctioned it back, right? They were at one time the biggest known holder of Bitcoin, the U.S. government was. And not only did they sell it back, they were very careful about it. And they sold it in tranches over 3 different periods over a year so it wouldn't swamp the market. And they auctioned them off and was very rational about it. And so when you hear anybody say, well, if it gets too big, the government's just going to shut it down. That's one of the silly myths that people that don't know, they'll keep saying to you. And they don't know, well, not only do they, you know, permit it, but they actually injected it back out into the economy. So I talked about that. Now, the thing that a lot of people don't know was there was 2 agents involved with busting the case open, a DEA agent and a Secret Service agent. And after, I don't know, a year, 18 months, people researching the blockchain later found evidence that they were corrupt. they were on the take with people's money. They could follow the money through the blockchain. And remember, you can never cover your tracks on the blockchain. Whatever is there is immutable and will always be there. So they found the DEA agent and the Secret Service agent too, and they didn't know each other. This wasn't a planned thing. They were both just happened to be doing different investigations on it. Both realized they were early to this and they could probably get away with it because none of their buddies understood. And they were heroes. They'd been working for the agencies for 20 years, I believe, from what I understand. And there happens to be, and I put a link to it, a TED talk from the federal agent that busted these guys. The federal agent out of San Francisco, she gave a nice 15-minute talk on the amazing work that the blockchain did and how it's now an agent for police to be able to uncover crimes. They say if you're trying to do uncover crimes that happen internationally, how hard it is to work with foreign governments to get banks to give up their records, and how much of a hassle it is for the paperwork they sell on the blockchain. You've got it on your own computer, everybody's got a copy of the blockchain. They have ones running on their server, and they do is run some applications on their server, start doing some searches, and voila, it's a government, an agency best friend if the people are not careful with it, I suppose. So here's their chart of the research that they did. This is their billboard and whiteboard, sort of, as she gave in her talk. The connections that they found and the fake names, and there's even a guy in Utah that was involved. It's all like, we have all these connections in Salt Lake. I don't know if a common technique they'll use, and I don't know if you watch the show Breaking Bad, is they'll do a fake death. So they'll put somebody there with some hamburger or whatever and some ketchup on the kitchen and put him down on the floor like he just got his head blown in or whatever, take a snap of a picture and then send it to his buddy and says, hey, he just gave up the goods on you and he's dead, so you better confess, come in, because these guys are after you or whatever. They did that with this guy in Salt Lake and said, you put out a gun for hire and wanted this assassination. Here's your proof, you got assassinated. Anyway, that's how part of the ways they got to the Silk Road people in trouble and off the streets. So let's talk about Bitcoin obituaries. This is a really funny website, and it's just called, if you just Google it, bitcoinobituaries.com. And they keep a running total. As of yesterday, Bitcoin has officially died in the headlines 119 times and counting. The last death was, I think, just a couple of days ago. January 3rd, 2017, Bitcoin passes $1,000, but only the matter that matters is zero. Financial Technology Times, or FT from London, they're big fans of Bitcoin. They never put a positive thing out there, and it's about to die. Every time they put a headline, and that's one of the funny ones I like to watch, just to watch them try and cover themselves. So if you follow this, shorts by a year, and I will also tell you the price the day that the Bitcoin was declared dead, and you'll see it from chronological of when it was $10, $30, $50, $100. It was dead every time they said. And so this is one of the signs that Roger Ver put up, the big billboard. Bitcoin is the honey badger of money. So if there was ever a symbol or an animal or a mascot for Bitcoin, it's the honey badger. And I don't know if you've ever seen the honey badger YouTube video. It's kind of infamous, but the honey badger doesn't take crap from anything. It's been in the world record book as the toughest animal that there is in nature. And when you watch that video, you understand why. It's bad. So Bill Rice, a member in our group, asked me if I wouldn't mind making sure people have a link to know that we have our meetup, the Bitcoin meetup group, or the blockchain meetup group in Salt Lake City. There'll be a link to this in the PowerPoint presentation if you want to just hit the link. But welcome new members all the time, and we're having a meetup on Saturday. So if you hit the website, you can join the group. It doesn't cost anything, and we show up, and it's called the Impact Hub in Salt Lake City, downtown Salt Lake. We'll build a new one we all kind of meet up at, and you never know what you're going to find there at the meetup. Sometimes you get a big crowd, and sometimes they have vendors come in. There's a company called Storage that relocated to the Salt Lake that they have their own coin that allows you to use your disk space. You can own this coin, and then you allot your free disk space. You can do a partition, and it becomes part of a web of hard drives that people can rent out and use. So you can. Their coin has become popular, and they are worth millions of dollars now, and they They are from Salt Lake and decided to come back, and so that's one of hundreds of coins that you can watch their value of, and it stays in the top 20. It's a popular coin, and they're still building the company up and did some technology demos. It's pretty cool. So we have, like I said, on the links at the end of this presentation, you'll see all this. And I like to learn off of YouTube, so I can be doing other things. So this page is all just YouTube videos. It's informational learning, documentaries, the TED Talk, for example. Some Bitcoin instruction. There's a guy that did a Bitcoin 101 Blackboard series that really gets in depth on some of this stuff. It's fascinating. I learned a lot when I was in the early days of me learning. I learned a lot from his website. And just goofy things. 53 songs about Bitcoin. Such a funny group. The libertarians are the first to grab onto this and have this currency that's not regulated or controlled by a state or a country. And the wackiness that ensues as they do, they go to these camps and sing songs. And so there's actually a group, someone's collected 53 songs that the people have written about Bitcoin. Now, how many currencies have other people written songs about that they love so much? The British pound, I can't recall any wonderful songs about the British pound or the euro. People are singing praises about the euro. So anyway, some funny, interesting history that's unique to Bitcoin. And then I have just regular links as well that you can get to. And that's the end of that presentation. So do you have any questions for me before we break? Does anybody, how early did anybody, did anybody get in like 2013 that's in the crowd here? Anybody involved? How much was Bitcoin when you first, did you buy a Bitcoin? Have you bought Bitcoin?
I was just learning about it at that time. I had Bitcoin, yeah, but not back then.
So, yeah, interesting. I like to, when I'm in doing presentations, find out who the old timers are, and then that's kind of you kind of guess about what time of its lifetime it was by how much was the price. Did you understand that when it was, so for me, for example, I first read about it, it was $30. But by the time I got the courage to go, I'm just going to go spend a little bit to see what happens, it was $40. And it was like a week later. $40, that's my entry point. So that turned out pretty good. But when I did it, it was really weird because the only place really that you could buy it was at Mt. Gox. It was in Japan. And how do you get money to Japan? That's tricky. And so we had to do money grams. We had to go to the grocery stores where a lot of people don't have bank accounts, pay their bills through money grams. And they're like, what do you need this money for? And because they're used to giving it to the unbanked people that may not be that financially savvy. And so they would kind of question, are you sure that this person's in business and it's not scamming you? And no, yeah, I know what I'm doing. So that was, and then I did my first wire transfer to a Japanese bank. And you think your money is your money in the bank. Have anybody done an international wire transfer?
Yeah.
I could not believe the questions they asked me. They can actually refuse to do a wire transfer with your own money if they don't think that it's right. I'm going to Japan, and I sat down probably with an hour worth of questions for them. They'd never heard of this Mt. Gox thing. They didn't know anything about Bitcoin. And if they did, they might have said, oh, that sounds like a legal currency, we're not going to be involved with that. So,
what's interesting is that it can take up to a week to 10 days for those funds to settle if you're transferring stuff.
Right, he said it could take 10 days for it to transfer, which in my case was actually a good thing because at that point it was in a super high. It had gone from 70 to 100 to 150, and I'm like, oh, get there before it goes to 1,000. Hurry and get there. Got to 266, and I'm cringing. They didn't credit your account back then. The day they got it in the bank, at the exchange, was the day you just got it at that price. And so I'm cringing, wondering, as it skyrockets, and then it crashed down to $60, and that's when my check hit. I was like, yes! So the $266 and buy-in, I can't remember how I bought. I think I sent a check for $1,000 away. Instead of getting four, whatever, I ended up getting, 10 or whatever the difference was. And so, actually, timing is everything, I guess. That one worked out. But every many times I wish I would have bought more. Still kept going up, and I still kept thinking, that 30, when it was 30 or $40, if I would just, whatever, and all the shouldas and wouldas and couldas. Doesn't help, I guess, but yeah, that's money transfer, and that's one of the big use cases, you know, especially international wire transfers being done in minutes versus days. So that's we're looking forward to that. Any other questions?
Do you have that on YouTube, the presentation you just showed? I just missed like the first 10 minutes.
I will. He is recording it, so I will have that available one of these days here coming up. So did y'all, I sent out links to the shared drive. Did y'all see the email that I had sent? Did you try accessing the PowerPoints of the video presentation from last week? If you were there, you know, it's nothing that you haven't seen already, but try to make that available. And I think it turned out kind of cool, actually, being able to see that and then have the PowerPoint. So if you have two monitors, you can have the video on one and the PowerPoint on the other to kind of, you know, keep up. So it turned out pretty cool. So anyway, with that, let's call a break. You guys go stretch your legs and remember the drinking fountains and bathrooms are. And we'll pick this up in about 10 minutes.